we have gathered here to praise God and to witness to our faith as we celebrate the life of Jim Van Ness. We come together in grief, acknowledging our human loss. May God grant us grace that in pain we may find comfort, in sorrow, hope, in death, resurrection.
I deeply respect and admire Jim as a professor and as a person. I will always remember him for his kindness, warmth, openness for helping his students become successful. He was a great mentor and a great and I will miss him.
He encouraged us to learn about and participate in current events. He was always up to date on current affairs. He watched the news whenever he could, sometimes 3 or more times a day, and read the newspaper every day. Mom and Dad had a very special relationship. They were devoted to one another. Dad, Mom, and I went great whale watching one spring in Baja, California. On a boat ride down there, the water was very rough and Mom was extremely seasick. As she put it, we were afraid she was going to die, and she was afraid she wouldn't. Dad was so concerned about her, and it really showed. Once down in Baja, Mom did much better. Our fellow passengers commented to me how cute a couple Mom and Dad were. Their affection and care for one another was very evident. They had a very open and honest relationship. They were true soulmates. My dad was a wonderful father, husband, grandfather, and overall person. I am so glad that he was my dad.
I think whoever he was in your life, whether he was a father, a husband, an uncle, a brother, grandfather, I think we can all agree he was one of the true greats, and we're all lucky to have him be who he was in our lives. That's all.
And as an engineer, my grandfather clearly took great joy in discovering and creating things. And as a teacher, he clearly took great joy in guiding others to discover and create things. And what was happening in these visits, when I played with the toys and when he took me and my brother to the museums, was that he was showing us kind of the joys of the engineering profession. Not so much the joys that come from learning differential calculus, but the fundamental joys of figuring out how the world works, how to build something out of this knowledge, even if that something was just an erratic mess of Lincoln logs. Now, I never got the math bug, and I never understood what an eigenvalue was. But in my own way, I grew up and started delving into my own lifelong passions, wilderness exploration, studying literature, philosophy, and history, many things that my grandfather was also interested in.
Dad wrote a weekly letter to our family, first by making carbon copies and later on the computer. Fortunately, our family archivist, my sister Meg, saved these letters. So I will begin first with my father's response to being presented with the first collection of those letters, and that's already 36 years ago that it happened. So January 2nd, 1980. Dear family, did I mention that Margaret had collected a 5-year set of these masterpieces and put them in a binder and gave them to me as a Christmas present? I can just see them being published as a literary masterpiece 100 years from now. Be that as it may, we do have a documented history of the family for that period of time now. Eventually, that collection of letters went back to the late 50s. The next selection gives a touching snapshot of his affection for his 4 girls. Each one a very special individual for him. From the Christmas letter, 1960. Becky is now 9.5 years old and is in the 4th grade, Browning and taking piano lessons. She is an excellent student, loves school, books, cooking, sewing, and almost everything else. closest we've come to a boy. She loves trains, trucks, and cars more than dolls. Julie, 21 months old, is an institution all by herself. We call her, affectionately, of course, Tornado Julie. 30 pounds of energy, excitement, and fun, and a head full of black hormones. Now we fast forward to an early milestone in Mom and Dad's marriage, and hear Dad reflect on the wonderful companionship that he and my mom enjoyed in their many travel adventures together. From the Christmas letter, 1974. Our 25th wedding anniversary was last December 28th, so we celebrated by going to Bermuda in January. We had a wonderful time. Afterward, we really shocked our children by sending them pictures of us on our motorbikes, crash helmets and all, after years of preaching against motorcycles. And I have to give a little note, I still remember a great snapshot of Mom and Dad looking quite jaunty on their mopeds tooling around Bermuda. Now that letter was written and sent out by carbon copy, typed on a manual computer, but the times, they were a-changing. One thing that hadn't changed is his love and sense of competition with his only brother, Wayne. And this brings that up in the next one. So when that era of the carbon copy came to an end, brotherly competition between these two engineers came to the fore. October 26, 1981. Dear family, I am trying to use a little one-upsmanship on my little brother tonight. He has ordered a personal computer from IBM to have it home.
Whoa.
He has let it be known that he will start using it to do the family letters as soon as it arrives. In fact, he threatens to store old letters on it, and when pressed for time, to choose appropriate paragraphs from former letters and assemble them into a new one. Not to be undone, I am staying at school here tonight at the office, writing the family letter, oh, by the way, writing with two T's. The spelling is a sign of genius in that family. My dad had it, so that was a dream. So, writing the family letter on my terminal through our computer, parentheses, I am sure Wayne has a terminal on which he could do the same thing, but I want to leave him to it. About that time, grandchildren began to arrive. We now fast forward to 1990, when Alice and Jennifer drove to Minnesota with their mom, Julie, and their grandparents to visit Andrew and Peter, my sons. March 21st, 1990. The four kids had a great time together. It was interesting that Andrew liked to do things for Alex or watch over her, while Peter and Jennifer would pair up. But usually all four of them were doing something together, which usually was very active and a bit noisy. They go at a pace that old people like us, or maybe even their parents, could not keep up with for as long as they do, as the kids do. Sunday evening, they sat down for a minute to watch something on TV, and Jennifer immediately fell asleep, sound asleep. So maybe they aren't so far ahead of us. And then there's another grandchild, fifth grandchild. And 2 years later, Dad and Mom took a trip west and stopped in Colorado to see their youngest grandchild, Rose. March 25th, 1992. The last big stop was in Golden to visit Rosemary and her parents. She is delightful, talks a streak with a very large vocabulary, a friendly outlook on the Now we are trying to adjust to being home again, and it may take a while. My dad often ended these letters with something like, I guess that is the great news for tonight. I want to end by sharing a paraphrase of that. I guess that all those great letters make us even more grateful for the wonderful person Jim Van Ness continues to be as he lives in our memories.
young, our father got a set of boxing gloves, one for himself and one for another for us. The three of us would run around in our shorts, looking the part and acting like boxers. Jim and I would take turns with boxing with Dad. One Sunday afternoon, we were boxing one-on-one. The doorbell rang. There we were, three males in boxer shorts. Dad was the superintendent of schools, and it was a lady who wanted to apply for a teaching position. No, we didn't open the door. But there was a lot of scrambling that went on before we did. During Jim's senior year and my freshman year in high school, our dad died. This changed the dynamics of our family. Mother went to work, and after he graduated, Jim went off to the Navy for 2 years. His boat was a baby flat top. It was a small one, the USS Sicily, an aircraft carrier. They built the structure in Vancouver, Canada. Then they went to Seattle, and they put the equipment in it. Jim was the master of the radar system on that boat. Working on the radar was what got him into electronics. His first tour of duty, his final tour of duty, was a wonderful one. He and a boat went down the coast from Seattle to San Francisco, then to San Diego. From there, they went through the Panama Canal and up the other side, and finally to the Brooklyn Shipyard. And there he was done. He really enjoyed that cruise, and the boat never was in the war. When he returned, he went to Iowa State College. He got his BS in 3 years, and this is where he met a very special girl from Spencer, Iowa, Mary Ellen. Jim would pick her up, and they would go to his mother's because he was living home going to school. They would make popcorn, and they would study, then he would drive her back. After Iowa State, he went to Northwestern where he got his master's and PhD and never left. Except for twice, once for a sabbatical at Berkeley and a year as a visiting professor in Boston. Ah, the family letter started when Jim was in It was a way to keep track of where he was. I graduated from high school and got a job with the Forest Service in Montana. So I would write to our mother, and Jim would write to our mother, and then she would send each of us the other's letter, plus her phone that she typed with a carbon copy. This started in the summer of 1947 and continued until just a couple of years ago. So it existed well over 65 years. Through these letters, and both of us being engineers, plus Jim coming out to Portland and working on the Bonneville Power Administration during the summers, the age difference melted away, and we became closer as adults. Our families vacationed many times together, and in our later years, we traveled together with our wives. I'm Karen, my voice, want to leave you with a final parting thought that I heard recently and feel it reflects Jim and Wayne's relationship, and I've actually experienced myself. Siblings are more than brothers and sisters. They are your first friend, your best friend, and your lifelong friend. Thank you.
As many of you know, our grandfather wrote family letters every Wednesday night after starting at the way into the Navy after high school. He usually started with the weather and moved into more pressing topics, family updates, local politics, world news, and occasionally a movie review. He spent some time over the last, my sister and I spent some time over the last 2 weeks going through old letters. And we came to the day after Christmas in 2012, and Meg had put together a calendar with dates and quotes from old family letters, and Grandpa loved it. Or to quote him directly, I have just looked a little at it, but it will deserve a lot of study. It sounds like something he would say. Looking back at these dates and places, I was overcome with memories of a life well lived and a man well loved. He and my grandmother loved to travel. From Sweden to Africa, they toured the world and learned as much as they could about different cultures and places. With that same type of passion and gusto, Grandpa took to computers and technology, always being the first one in our family to try something new or purchase a new gadget. My cousin Rose followed his unyielding sense of curiosity, and I think that describes it perfectly. In the same family letter you mentioned earlier, Grandpa went on to say, Julie came back to our cottage after lunch and we opened presents. You all did very well for us and we thank you greatly. We are really grateful for all you do for us. But it is people who are grateful to you, Grandpa, for the way you encouraged us to explore the world and try new things, for the giving of yourself so generously and humbly, for valuing education and teaching us to do the same, and most of all, your unyielding acceptance and love.
We are the Van Ness bold, brave as a two-year-old. We cry when we get cold, we're telling you. And in our memory, into our hearts
will be.
And the family sure do shine all of the time.
He went on a very extended honeymoon that, I think it was two nights in Sioux City, Iowa.
Where's that?
And we went back to his mom's apartment.
Oh!
And this young man was there. And he thought he would be terribly, terribly clever. And he pulled a trick on us before we went to bed. After we climbed in bed, we could hear a little noise under the bed. And Jim went under the bed and discovered a big bent clock set for 2 o'clock in the morning. My alarm set by when we all got up in the morning, Wayne was wondering, what happened to the alarm clock?
Mary Ellen gave only part of their honeymoon.
Well, I hope so.
No. Their first night there, I think they were thinking other things because the floor I had painted as a wedding present, and they could hardly get their feet unstuck.
And who remembers Uncle Jim sneezes?
Yeah.
And who took the roof off.
And who inherited Uncle Jim sneezes? Nice.
One of my biggest fears in my life was that Jim and Wayne would be sitting in our living room and they'd both sneeze at the same time.
So we were known as the black and white Van Esses, but we were also known as the EVNs and the PVNs because we were the Evanston Van Esses or the Portland Van Esses.
I remember when we were little talking about how the Van Ness name, no, I don't need that. How the Van Ness name was going to go with the four of us, and all four of us kept our dad's last name.
Yeah,
true. All four of the Van Ness girls are Van Esses.
Sweet.